Well, it's an idea I had when I was 12 years old. When I was a kid that loved movies, and I always fantasized about what movies I would make in my fantasy career. And this was one of them. And I'd seen John Borman's movie Excalibur, and I'd also seen E.T., and I loved the idea of combining fantasy with, like, reality. And I thought, well, why not? Why has nobody made a movie where a normal British kid, like a British version of Elliot, instead of finding an alien, finds the sword in the stone? So that was an idea I had when I was a kid. And the amazing thing about the legend is, however little or much you know about it, these indelible devices stay with everybody. The sword in the stone, the lady in the lake, the round table, Camelot, Merlin. Even if you don't know the details, everybody knows these five or six incredible story devices. So it struck me that you could put them in modernity and come up with something fresh and new. I guess the legend is about a divided country. And this is the legend. So this is in 500 BC or something, you know, the 5th century. I always get it wrong. But a long time ago, Dark Ages. Britain is a land that's lost and leaderless. It's divided. There's no king. All the tribes are feuding against each other. So the legend is set in a divided country. And it was important for me to have that sense in the contemporary world so that I could play out the legend in the same way. And for better or for worse, at the moment, the country, the world is a little bit more fractured than it usually is. So that was weirdly apposite. And then, you know, in terms of the kid being bullied, I like the idea of a vulnerable hero, a kid that tries to makes it clear that he stands for good and he tries to fight for good, so he has the qualities you'd look for a leader. Merlin's magic. Yeah. Well, we knew we needed a new sort of magic because everyone's had enough of pointing wands and saying Latin things. So I figured it would be good if he manipulated the elements, if the way his hands moved in thin air actually created physical effects. So we devised this thing called hand magic, which is gestures and rhythmic snaps and crackles and pops that he uses. So all the magic in the movie, we wanted to make feel like a physics experiment. So not like spangly Disney multicolored fairy magic, but like physics experiment magic with explosions and dust and sneezes and body fluids and physicality, so that it felt real. I like a recognizable reality, you know. I think a movie that's set in a world that we recognize with fantasy in it is really powerful, rather than it being on other planets or in sort of future versions of the world. Like, for me, what was exciting about E.T. was that alien coming to a place I recognized. What was amazing about the first Superman was it looked like the real New York, you know, even though it was Metropolis, right? So I love that combination of the real world and fantasy, and how it can make it can kind of elevate daily life. Because I'm so in awe of Patrick, it probably took me a little longer to be able to be relaxed with him than it did with a kid, where I can just go, come on, hurry up. But you know, the experience is very much the same. You're on a movie set, you've got limited time to get what you need, and you just have a straightforward dialogue with them about getting what you want. But it's a real thrill to have Patrick in the film, and a real honor to get to direct him. I love movies. I really love movies. There's some really great TV around, but I love movies because I like things that end. I like stories to have a beginning and a middle and an end. I love the experience of leaving a cinema after a story's complete and having that time to let it sort of resonate in your head. The feeling of the bright daylight after you've come out of a dark cinema. So that's my number one passion.